I didn't grow up with a dad. I didn't have that element in my life. The men that were in my life when I was growing up were pretty much like gangsters. And so I grew up as a thinking that I had to add up, thinking I had to be violent and do things that I know in my heart after I came to Christ that I shouldn't have done. And the reason why I'm sharing that with you now is because I shared this morning, but I didn't know it was going to hit me. God promised me when I got saved that He would bless not just me, but that He would bless my family and my future. And this was before I even met my wife. And my daughter was raised in Christ, and I'm watching my grandson talk about the power of God. And I don't know about you, but if you have children, if you have grandchildren, you know for a fact that when you invest those things, those ingredients, the attributes of who God is in their lives, they don't go into life ignorant of who God is in their lives. So whenever they go through changes, even when they make mistakes, even when they go through their ups and downs and their trials and tribulations, they know that there is a God that loves them. They know that there is a God that has the power to set them free. They know without a shadow of a doubt what they've been taught. Can I get an amen? And the reason why I'm saying that is because I didn't grow up with that. And so if you can relate to what I'm about to say to you before I get into my message, then just raise your hand. If I would have knew what my children, my grandchildren, if I would have knew what they know, I think I would have avoided many years of pain, many years of suffering, many years of mistakes, many years of madness. If you're here today and you're in agreement with me, just raise your hand. Amen? Doesn't mean we didn't know there was a God, but we didn't know who He was. It wasn't really revealed to us. And so VBS is something that's been very special in my heart, but not because of just the work, because the volunteers, they're awesome. Every single one of them, they are awesome. But the reality is that every time I see the kids being ministered to and then ministering to us, I get blessed because my Father in heaven keeps reminding me about what He promised me. And like Pastor says, I'm a bad guy just trying to do good. Well, I'd be honest with you, I know without a shadow of a doubt that I brought nothing to Christ but what I didn't want. And He gave me all that I needed. Now, some of you here might have caught that, and some of you here might have not caught that, but every one of us in this room today came to Christ and gave Him everything we didn't even want ourselves. And He said, I'll take that from you, and I'm going to give you things that you didn't even ask me for. I'm going to bless your life in an abundant way. And so whenever we do VBS, I walk around real grateful. I walk around being healed in my heart because of things that I remember, life and experiences of the past. And that leads me into my message this morning, because they spoke about all week long about the power of God, as you heard the points that they showed you. And they spoke about Mount Everest, climbing this mountain through the mighty power of God, the mighty hand of God. And so when they asked me to speak, I pretty much was like, Lord, what do I speak about concerning a mountain? And the Lord gave me, put something in my heart that I wanted to share with you that showed me a while back from my personal life. And I thank God for that personal encounter I had with the word that I'm going to share with you today. And so I'm probably going to step away from my notes because it's very personal. So I pray that you receive it. It's about mountains, challenges in our lives, a mountain of challenges in our lives. And it's not Mount Everest, it's Mount Sinai in the book of Exodus. So if you would turn there with me to the book of Exodus, chapter 3, and I'm going to take you. How many want to climb a mountain with me today? Come on. You want to climb with me today? Why don't you stand to your feet, open up to Exodus chapter 3. I believe they're going to show it on the screen also if you don't have your Bible with you. And we're going to open up with Exodus chapter 3, verse 7 through 12. And it's a little warm up here. I know it might be a little warm down there, but the Word of God is going to be your AC right now, okay? Lock in to what God wants to tell you. Verse 7 through 12, and then we're going to say a word of prayer. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows. So I, God, have come down to deliver them. Those words right there are very powerful. God himself is telling Moses, so I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from the land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. I'm getting feedback on this microphone. To the place of the Canaanites, Hittites, and Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Verse 10, come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? Verse 12, so he said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign that to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I come before you, and I ask, Lord, that you would help me to communicate your word. I pray that you would calm my heart, calm my spirit to be effective in communicating your word and your message. But I pray, Father God, that you would help everyone in the sanctuary to put aside all their thoughts, their things to do list, and lock in so that they can get a visual of what you're saying to them today. I pray that no one leaves here without receiving something from you. I pray that everyone here would be challenged and that your word would be illuminated within our lives so that it can bear much fruit within us. We give you all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning. When you look at this portion of scripture, you'll notice that God has called Moses. And he tells Moses, I hear the cry of my people, and that I've come down to set them free. And the reason why he's telling him that is because God, at this very moment, is telling Moses, I want you to deliver the people out of Egypt because I want to have a personal relationship with them. I want to have a relationship with them where they will be my people and I will be their God. Now, every one of these people is very important that you understand that every one of them, just like you and me today, every single one of them experienced deliverance from Egypt. Every one of them experienced being saved from their taskmasters. Every one of them experienced freedom from being enslaved here in Egypt. Every one of them had the same encounter coming out of Egypt. Now, they began the journey to Mount Zion, Sinai, and as they make their journey throughout the wilderness, it's very important that we understand that many things began to happen. God revealed himself in many different ways. For instance, one of the ways God revealed himself was through a cloud by day, meaning that the sun was so powerful during the day in the wilderness that it very hot, for the sun beaming on you. 3 million people walking through the desert, and God has a cloud that's covering them and watching over them and protecting them from the elements of the atmosphere. As the cloud moved, they were to move. Then we also see through the word of God that one of the other provisions for the children of Israel was that in the evening, they would have a pillar of fire that would protect them, that would light up the area and keep them from predators and things to that effect. Now, I don't know about you, but I never had that kind of an experience where a pillar of fire would appear at night or a cloud would follow me and protect me during the day. I never visualized that, but they did. They seen this daily. for all the years that they were in the wilderness. Then God provided food. He provided manna from heaven. He provided quail, which were small birds, as meat. He even turned around and one time they got to a place where they had to drink water, and the water was bitter. And God made the bitter water sweet so they can drink it. Then one time they were there in the middle of the wilderness, and God just, I guess, wanted to impress them with his power, as the kids would say, hold on, right, with the power of God. And he tells Moses to strike the rock, and the rock began to shoot water out and provided water. Now, to you and me, these are just miracles that we read about. But just imagine being there with them and witnessing what was taking place. Overwhelming. Outrageous. Extraordinary. Things that they were able to experience about who God was to them in the wilderness. The people that were being delivered or got delivered out of Egypt had this divine or special relationship that was taking place with God. And so they were witnessing miracles and signs and wonders. They were having a great time as God was manifesting in all these different ways. If someone can help me. But the reality is this. Each and every one of them in the wilderness were enjoying the outpouring of God's blessings. God's motive wasn't just to provide the blessings, but it was to bring them to the foot of the mountain so that he can introduce himself to them, because he wanted them to be his people and him to be their God. Can I get an amen? So God wanted a personal relationship with them. God wanted a divine moment with them that was very personal between them and God. So we're going to climb this mountain now, because I needed to paint this understanding, paint this type of picture to give you a clear understanding that the people had all the provision that they can possibly need in the wilderness. Open your Bibles with me to Exodus chapter 20. And we're going to begin to climb this mountain. Because the reality is on this mountain something begins to take place. Exodus chapter 20, verse 18 and 19. Now all the people, these are the children of Israel, the same people. All these people, children of Israel, witnessed the thunders, the lightning. God came down on the mountain. They witnessed the thunder, the lightning, the flashes, the sound of the trumpet, and the mountain smoking. And when the people saw it, they trembled and stood afar off. Then they said to Moses, you speak with us and we will hear, but let not God speak to us, lest we die. Here the people are at the foot of the mountain after all these years in the wilderness of provision and everything, and here's their divine moment to meet the God that set them free, to have a personal relationship with their God. And when they get to the foot of this mountain, God's presence is so overwhelming on this mountain that it leads them to a place that things that are on the inside manifest on the outside. What do you mean by that, Pastor Joe? Well, when they got to the foot of the mountain and seen the awesomeness of God, the Bible says, one, they stood afar off. They didn't draw closer to God. They drew back from God. Now, the reason why they drew back from God was because of fear that was within them. They were afraid about what they were experiencing. So now the God that had just revealed himself in every way of provision was now revealing himself to them, and they were afraid of that. Is it possible that they were afraid because they were still associating what they were experiencing with what they experienced in Egypt? Is it possible that they were looking at God and thinking that God was just another Pharaoh? Is it possible that they still had enough Egypt inside of them that they still didn't get delivered from Egypt within them? Just because God delivered them from the location that they were in Egypt, he brought them out of Egypt. But is it possible that while they're standing before God, now what's happening is that what's inside them is being manifested, and what was inside them was still Egypt? They still had the Egypt mentality. They still had the Egypt issues. And one of them was they were enslaved. They were under a taskmaster. They were under a hand of an oppressor. And now they're looking at God, having an experience with God. And while they're having this experience, they're thinking, he's going to rule over us. He's going to hold us down. He's going to make us slaves. Because they can't associate anything different than what they came out of. You see, the reality is that they might have been standing at the foot of this mountain and just found themselves very ignorant to who God was. They knew about God, but they didn't know who he was. They never had that developing relationship. So at this very moment, instead of feeling the desire to run towards God or move towards God, their response is stand afar off, and then they made a big, huge mistake. They decided to tell Moses, well, why don't you talk to God, and when God talks to you, you come back and talk to us, when all along, God never told Moses that was his desire. His desire was that I will introduce myself at the foot of this mountain. They will be my people. I will be their God. Can I get an amen? They decided, somebody say, they decided. Moses, you go talk to God and tell us what he said. Is it possible that the people that are at the foot of this mountain is like the church today? Is it possible that we came to Christ, Christ has revealed himself to us? Because the reality is, you know, let's keep it real. In the midst of the provision and the miracles and the touch, the Bible says the children of Israel rejoiced every time God provided. Every time God provided, the people had no problem dancing, singing, praising God, and giving him all the glory and honor for everything he did. As long as the hand of God was providing, oh, they were partying. But now it was time to seek his face, not his hand. Now it was time to meet their maker. And they didn't know how to handle that. Is it possible that in Christ, in Christianity today, we come to Christ, we're standing at the foot of the mountain, and we don't move from that place? Is it possible that we get to that place and we know about God, but instead of saying, God, we want to draw closer, we kind of take two steps back because maybe it's easier to think about my sin being hidden from here than being exposed in his presence. Maybe if I just stay here. See, because they could hide their sin in the celebration. As long as they were celebrating and jamming and having a good time, they could hide their sin and leave, they could do that. That wasn't a problem. But to walk into the presence of God, your sin would be revealed. And that's what God wanted. God wanted to reveal to them how much they needed him. And because they fall short of the glory of God, can I get an amen? Amen? That's why Moses told the people, God is not here to hurt you. He's here to test you. He's here to reveal to you that the issues of old can be passed away. It's like the whole gospel is being spoken. And by the way, tonight at 6:30, this message is going to be getting taught in a typology of where you can find Christ tonight at 6:30 by Pastor Jeremias, okay? So I want you to make sure you be there, because I'm going to be sitting there just receiving, because it's very important that everything we talk about in the Old Testament, that we see Jesus Christ, that we see the New Testament, the New Covenant, and everything we're speaking. And so it's very important that we identify with the people at the foot of this mountain, because we can be people also that can be saved, washed in the blood. This doesn't have nothing to do with your salvation. You're saved, washed in the blood, But just like the children of Israel, you never go any further than the foot of the mountain. And you come every Sunday hoping that a man will feed you and speak to you and give God to you. When all along our Heavenly Father says, yes, be faithful to the house of God, be faithful to the assembling together of your saints, of the saints, but the reality is that I want to be your God and you are to be my people. I will feed you. Can I get an amen? Amen. How many of you here agree that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit? So in reality, God wants to move through your life each day, every day. So your first challenge this morning at the foot of this mountain is you can't stay at the foot of the mountain. And if you're lacking discipline with the Word of God or lacking knowledge of who God is, you can't stay at the foot of the mountain. You need to begin to stir up that passion within you and say, Lord, I will not stand afar off. I will not worship from afar. I will draw nigh unto you. Can I get an amen? The second one, if you could turn with me, for the sake of time, I'm trying to paraphrase a lot of stuff. Exodus chapter 19, verse 24. Then the Lord said to him, this is Moses and God having a dialogue. Then the Lord said to him, away, get down, and then come back up. You and Aaron with you. You see that up there? And Jehovah said unto him, Moses, go thee down, and thou shalt come up, thou and Aaron with thee. So Moses is to do what? Shout it out to me. Come on. Moses is to do what? Go back down, yes? And come back up with who? Moses is to go down and come back up with Aaron. Chapter 20, verse 21. So the people stood afar off, but Moses drew near the thick darkness where God was. In between 19 and 20, these two chapters, many things took place. But here in the scripture that I gave you first is that God is telling Moses, go back down, get your brother Aaron, and bring him up with you. Does it say bring him up halfway? Does it say bring him up a quarter way? It just says bring him up with you. With you is insinuating bring you up to the place that you're standing right now. Go back down from where you're standing and bring him up here with you. This next verse that I read you, the Bible says that Moses enters in to the thick cloud of God. My question to you, where's Waldo? I mean, where's Aaron? Where's Aaron? Everybody look at your neighbor and say, where's Aaron? You see, I got a problem with this, and if you get the answer, come back to me because I'm searching this. I'm bouncing it off all the pastors because it's very important. What God showed me was this. Nowhere in Scripture does it show me anything different. God is clear. Get Aaron and bring him up. Then all of a sudden, the next time we hear about anything, it's Moses entering in without Aaron. Is it possible that Aaron had an opportunity presented by God because he did good? Because he, not merit on favor or because his work ethic or anything like that, but because of deliverance of the children of Israel, now God was saying, bring Aaron with you because I want to talk to Aaron too. Now, he was having a divine appointment. For Moses to be told, go down and get Aaron, it was like, listen, go get Gail and bring her up with me, as if I want to talk to her too. Bring her up here. And so he goes down. But then when you see him entering in, Aaron's not there. Is it possible that Aaron never took the appointment seriously? Is it possible that Aaron missed out on a divine appointment with God? What in the world could possibly be within any human being that when a word from God comes to enter into his presence, that would stop them from coming? That you would not think that it was important? This blew me away. Aaron, chosen of God, a chosen high priest, a chosen leader to the people, separated for 3 million people, a leader among leaders. Can I get an amen? Oh. And does not take advantage of the appointment. 24 verse 19 and 9, 24, 9 through 14. Stay with me, please. Then Moses went up, also Aaron, Nabib, Habihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw God of Israel and were under his feet as it was paved work of sapphire gold. Is this it? 9 through 14, yes. Keep reading. Verse 11. But on the nobles of the children of Israel, he did not lay on his hands, so they saw God. Then the Lord said to Moses, come up to me unto the mountain and be there, and I will give you tablets of stone and the law of the commandments. So Moses arose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up to the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, wait here for us until we come back. Somebody say that with me. Wait here until we come back. Say it. You're not convincing me. Say, wait here until we come back. You see, Aaron, for some reason, didn't make it to where he was supposed to make it on the first go around, but God still gave him favor. How many people know that when we make mistakes in life, that God seems to find ways in our lives to work things out for us? Can I get an amen? And just because you made a mistake the first time doesn't mean that he's not going to try to bless you again. And he gives you a second chance. And so here in this portion of scripture, Aaron is getting a second chance. He turns around, God turns around and says, Aaron, you, her, and your sons, and the elders, bring them up, but you will worship from afar. So the appointment that he had to come all the way up, now he was told you can only come halfway, or whatever that level was. And he's there. And his instructions were clear. Wait here for us. Wait here for us when we come down. Now, Aaron, high priest, leader of the people, seemed to have an issue with leaning on his own understanding. For some reason, he decided to go back to be with the people. For some reason, when Moses comes down, Aaron is not where he's supposed to be. And since he's not where he's supposed to be, where is he? Anyone know? Shout it out. He's down with the people. Doing what? Creating a golden calf. Hello, McFly. So not only was he not where he was supposed to be, not only was he waiting where he was supposed to be waiting, but he decided to go back down. Is it possible that even though we're Christians and we're leaders, even though that there's leaders that are called by God, chosen by God, separated for God's work, is it possible that we just like to lean on our own understanding? Is it possible that we find more comfort? I pray you hear what I'm about to say to you. Is it possible that Aaron found more comfort in the presence of the people than he did in the presence of God? I'm going to say that again for those on this side of the room. Is it possible that Aaron found more comfort in the presence of the people than he did in the presence of God? So instead of waiting for whatever the blessing was that was coming down from this mountain, after reneging on it the first time, now you have to stay here at this place. Instead of doing the right thing here, knowing that I messed up the first time, I end up going back down, and not only going back down and leaning on my own understanding, but going back down, leaning on my own understanding, and giving them another God? Giving them something else? He begins to lead them in a direction that's not even of God? Is it possible that Aaron needed to be in the presence of God and now all of a sudden he's struggling with his identity? Can I get an amen? The truth of the matter is this. God's favor and mercy was still on Aaron because God had chosen him to be who God chosen him to be. Because of the title that God ordained this man to be, God gave him grace. God gave him mercy. God gave him favor. Over and over, all his mistakes, you notice, you keep reading, you'll notice Aaron never got really dealt with because of the mercy of God. Doesn't change the fact that you and me, we need to be in God's presence. We need to draw closer to God. We need to be in the Word of God. We can't just celebrate and sing and not know who our God is that we're singing and celebrating to. Can I get an amen? The next one. We're going to talk about Joshua. For the sake of time, you guys read it. It's all in these portions of scripture from 19 to 25, something like that. Joshua is the gentleman that is the word we. Matter of fact, the version we read a few minutes ago, that was Joshua's name there. The Bible says that Moses said, wait here to Aaron and all the people. And he says, wait until we come back. The we person that he's talking about was Joshua. He wasn't going by himself. He was going with Joshua, which was his assistant. And so we is him and Joshua. So they go. Then the Bible goes on to say that Moses enters into the thick cloud of God. Where does that leave Joshua? Right outside the presence of God. Now, I don't know about you, but when I first got saved, I didn't need to be tickled with the Word of God. I needed a transformation of God in my life. I am a Joshua. There is no doubt about it. I am a Joshua. A man that doesn't play. A man that stands strong for God. A man that will fight the fights that need to be fought. But to be in the presence of God, the biggest crybaby you'll ever find. The one that has a passion and a desire to just sit and be as close to God as possible. Like John at the bosom of Christ. Joshua finds himself going up with Moses and he's there at the glory cloud, at the presence of God. 40 days and 40 nights. I choose to believe that while he was up there, God delivered him. God set him free. God did something deep inside of him. God began to heal the wounds of Egypt. And not only did God deliver and set him free from Egypt, but God delivered Egypt out of him. When he came down off that mountain, Egypt did not exist in Joshua any longer. That's why in the book of Numbers, you'll notice they say, and they were of another spirit. They were of another spirit, him and Caleb, that they were of another spirit. Something was different about Joshua. I believe it began by the presence of God. I believe it began because he had a passion to be in the presence of God. Later on, as the tabernacle is built, Moses has to enter into the tabernacle. The Bible says Joshua was the one that stood at the door. Some people would say he was guarding it from people entering. I don't believe that. I believe that most people were scared to death to enter and knew better than to enter. I think Joshua just wanted to get as close to God as he possibly could. I choose to believe that. I believe that wherever Moses went, because he knew he was chosen to be in God's presence, that he was going to follow him because he knew he had the good thing. Where he's going, I want to go too. And if I can't enter in, I'm going to get as close as I can. I don't want what they have. I want what you have. Like Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. Are you with me this morning? I believe here this morning, there's people that are here, as Pastor Jeremiah and the worship team make their way. I believe here this morning that there's many people. We look at VBS, and our children have learned about the power of God. The power of loving forever, that God will love them forever. Power of healing. The power of forgiveness. The power of all these different attributes of God. And many of us have knowledge of these things. But yet, even though we have knowledge of God has the power to forgive, we have a hard time forgiving. Just say, ouch. Sometimes we'd rather hold people hostage in guilt than to release them in forgiveness. We received forgiveness freely, but oh boy, I'm not giving it up freely. You know what that means? That means we're at the foot of the mountain knowing about God, but not really knowing him. And when we get out from the foot of that mountain and draw closer to God, he teaches us how to forgive. He teaches us how to love. He teaches us how to be Christians. How to be the men and women that we really should be. At the foot of the mountain is when we first get saved. And sad to say, many times people come to the foot of the mountain and they want the provision. They need healing. They need deliverance. For those of you that know, a year ago, God healed me from hepatitis C. And some of you might think I'm saying that by faith. No, I'm clean. I have no hepatitis C. I'm done. I have none. God revealed himself to me in healing. I never even asked for it. You know why? I never asked for it. Because the reason why I got the hep C was because of the reckless life I was living. So in my mind, I deserved that. So I was okay with serving God with all my heart till the day I die. And my father turned around and said, I'm going to make you whole. I'm going to bless your life. I'm going to do things for you that you didn't even ask me for. And so when your father begins to talk to you like that, you have a choice. You ready? You have a choice. You can either say, I love what you're saying, but I don't know what it's like to trust you as my father because I never had a father. And the father that supposedly I had, he left. Didn't care. And so, are you going to leave me? Are you going to cut me loose? And he'll repeat to me, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. You see, we know the scriptures. Some of you are repeating them to me. But I'm not talking about what you know up here. I'm talking about what you experienced with him. Children of Israel, they experienced it with God. And that's what God wants for you. He wants you to experience his love. And that's what VBS is about. VBS is about the children not just knowing about him, but coming to a place where they can experience that those things that we're talking about. Please stand to your feet this morning. Please just stand to your feet and just be still. Moses entered into the glory cloud. Now hear me and hear me good. And we're closing. We're talking about a mountain this morning. Mount Sinai. Because of the cross of Jesus Christ, because of the blood that was shed, because of what he did for us, there is no more mountain that we need to climb. Because you have accepted Jesus Christ into your life, he's cleansed you of all your sins, chosen that you would be the temple of the Holy Spirit, and gave you complete access to boldly, someone shout boldly, enter into his courts with praise. Enter into the presence of God. No one needs to go for you. You have access for yourself. So knowing that he that the Son sets free is free indeed, knowing that, can you stay at the foot of the mountain? You can't. Can you stay at whatever level you're at in the sense of how much you know about him? Or how much you're experienced with him? Can you stay there? You can't. You know why? Your father is saying it very clear to you today. Draw closer to me. I want to be your God, and you are to be my people. And it's very personal. It's a very personal relationship with him. It's not perfection. It's not perfection. But it is God's love affair with you. So today we're able to see the mountain. And Christ, playing field is even now. You know why? There's no mountain. You know why? We all fall short of the glory of God. We're all sinners, but yet while we were all sinners, Christ died for us. So today, as you bow your heads, you have to ask that question. As you bow your heads with me this morning, you have to ask that million-dollar question. Where are you at in your love affair with God? Maybe you see yourself at the foot of the mountain and you know it's time to move forward. You got to draw closer to God. Maybe you see yourself as an Aaron and you're doing everything that seems to look like everything that's supposed to look like, but your heart is far from God. You actually drifted back to a place that you were not supposed to be. Maybe you're a Joshua and you got a passion in you and you want more of God. Wherever you see yourself today, I want you to evaluate it right now. See yourself. It's okay. Because just like them, the Bible says that God comes down to test us. And that's what he's doing right now with you. He's testing you. He's speaking to you right now. What will you do with this relationship with God? As all your heads are bowed and eyes closed, if you're here today before we open up the altars, if you're here today and you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, or you have not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, and you know that today is the day, if that's you, all I want you to do is get out of your seat right now. That tugging in your heart, that's him. Just get out of your seat and make your way right to the front of the pulpit. Just draw right up right now. If you're here today and you need to accept the Lord Jesus Christ into your life. Prepare me to be a sanctuary. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm going to open up the altars. I don't know how any easier or any clearer that it could be explained. But every single one of us here in the sanctuary this morning is in some situation or some level of our Christian walk. And I want to encourage you today to take a few minutes out of your time, of your day, and talk to your Creator. Talk to your God and begin to draw closer to him this morning.